Glad the Magnolia team swam upstream, came over today. Thank you, brother. It's good to see you in church. Some of y'all don't know, but when Jesus does come, it says on an hour when you think not.
Yes.
That's Sunday morning when it's raining.
There you go.
So it could be today. Aren't you glad you're in church? It's good to see you today. Had a great worship service the other campus. And don't even text me late at night asking me if we're having church. You know now, right? We have to boat in, we're going to have church. We've done that before, haven't we? For those who've been around for a while. We met across the street because we couldn't get in. So, in the parking lot. We're going to have church, amen? Greatest thing we do in life, I love Sundays, getting together with God's people and worshiping the Lord like that and fellowshipping together. I need that, you need that, we all need that, amen? So I'm glad you're in church today. Listen, we're in our series of messages entitled The Secret Place. And it's the topic of prayer, and I don't think we can teach and preach on prayer enough, but we'll try, amen. But last week, in dealing with this subject, and some of you are following in lift groups, and even though we don't have lift groups this evening, you'll be picking this lesson up along with next week's. And this week and next week are really the same sermon, so to say. It's in two parts, and it has to do with specifically and uniquely the will of God and how we pray. Last week, we looked at the priority of prayer in our life. We also looked at the price we pay when we don't pray. If we're not seeking God's face, if prayer's not a part of our life, how much it really cost us and cost in the context even of the kingdom of God. We finished last week's sermon in trying to make the point about how important prayer is. We finished the message with the disciples looking at the life of Jesus Christ, and they request Him, Lord, teach us to pray. We're going to look this morning at another question that flows in line with that. Remember, they asked that question in regard to seeing all that Jesus did and performing the works of God and seeing the miraculous happen. They immediately connected it with prayer in the life of Jesus. Often in the Gospels, you see Jesus going off to pray and seeking God's face. You see that model long before Jesus comes in the New Testament by all the prophets and those who came before and those who sought God's face and all the heroes of faith, as we like to call them. They were people of prayer and they were people of faith. We talked about last week how that our prayerlessness is a demonstration of our lack of faith. We don't pray because we don't really believe that God answers or believe that God can and will move on our behalf. And so either by being slothful and spiritually lazy, or ignorance on our part, or just by the fact that we don't have faith to trust God, we just don't pray many times. We'll pick up with another question the disciples asked today, and this, like I say, this is really a two-part sermon that gets into this. And the disciples ask in John 6:28, that just jumped to the wrong slide. Would you get to the first slide for me? The disciples ask in John 6:28, therefore they said to Him, what shall we do so that we may do the works of God? The second verse behind that, next verse, verse 29, and Jesus answered to them and said, this is the work of God, that you believe in Him who He has sent. Now, people say, huh, what's that mean? Does that mean that the work of God is to believe on Jesus? That's first and foremost. And Jesus is laying out a lesson here. And all of John 5 is a real powerful message on the priority of prayer and how it works and how. Remember, in this passage in John 5, He's teaching the disciples about the works of God, about faith and belief. But he's making an important part here, you know, and we'll see it exposed a little bit more as we get to the end of the message, how that all the works of God and the great things that God did came as a result of Jesus's prayer life. And they saw that. And Jesus is teaching them earlier when He says, and they ask, how do we pray? He gave them that model of prayer. Now we're moving down the road a little bit where they're talking about, well, all these great works, how are they done? And He gets back down to this point. It's to believe. It's to believe. You know, what do we believe? Well, we believe the Word of God. And a little later in this passage, we're going to bring out John chapter 15 and also John chapter 5 some more where we'll talk about where He says, hey, here's the way it works, boys. Here's what I do. Here's how God moves. And He gives really just a simple principle of faith and belief that's all wrapped up in this principle. The bottom line is about prayer and how we pray and what we pray. I remember saying, I guess it was week before last, about when we get to our prayer studies in the lift group, that the lift leaders could make mention of a simple formula that a lot of people use when they're teaching on prayer about the aspects and the important parts of prayer. And it's the word ACTS, which is adoration, confession, thanksgiving, and supplication. And they say, well, that's the four most important parts of prayer. Well, I want to look at that a little differently today and break it down just a little different. I'll talk about three aspects of prayer, which really include those four things, but we kind of bundle them to three things because I believe it's kind of a directional thing. There's this upward element of prayer, there's this inward element of prayer, and there's this outward element of prayer. And I think those are the three aspects that I want to look at today. And we'll start with the one that's the upward. It's communion. In Romans it says, we've been justified by faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. That's a good verse. Listen to the rest of it. Through whom also we've obtained our introduction by faith into the grace in which we stand and we exalt in the hope of the glory of God. In other words, he's saying here, because you have committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can now have fellowship with God. You can have a relationship with God. You can stand by grace now in the presence of God. You have access. You can rejoice in His presence. You rejoice in His glory and His grace because you've been saved. You've been blood washed. The way that all fellowship with God starts is at the cross of Jesus Christ. You have to have a personal commitment to Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior. It's not sufficient to just be religious. It's not sufficient to just have a church membership or a church home or something. There has to be a personal work between you and God, a transaction that's taken place. It's kind of like, you know, you're not going to get cell phone service till you got a cell phone. Amen. It's not doing any good. When we come to Christ, we yield our life to Him, and now we have this receiver inside us now. And the receiver is the presence of the Holy Spirit in the life of the child of God. The Bible says, if any man hath not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. So we've given our life to Jesus Christ. In doing that, it has opened the door to this personal relationship. Now I can know God. The bottom line of all prayer starts right here, of knowing God, communing with God, and fellowshipping with God. If we don't understand that and we don't get that down, then we'll never do it. We just finished our marriage retreat, and one of the things we talked about was the importance of expressing to the other person in the marriage relationship and communicating with them appreciation and acceptance and love and thankfulness and gratitude. And we spent some time on that in the marriage retreat. I sat at my desk on Thursday. I have a little Windows 8, and the news items will pop up occasionally. And an item popped up on that says, psychiatrists discover the secret to long marriage. Come on, guys, read your Bibles. It tells us all right there. But anyway, they finally discovered something. And this was a secular article written by secular scientists and consultants and psychiatrists and psychologists and sociologists and other judges. And they came out and they said, the secret to a long marriage is learning how to appreciate, communicate, and speak to one another words of adoration and acceptance. Most people don't do that. Most people are too busy complaining with each other, griping about things, pointing out each other's failures, nagging each other about that problem, not communicating. And here it is. It's all about communion. Well, let me tell you, your Christian life, it's all about communion. It's all about spending time with God. It's all about knowing your Heavenly Father. It's all about understanding His will and purpose in your life. And now that I've been saved, and if I've come to Christ and have this relationship, the Holy Spirit now lives in my life, now I can relate. Now I can fellowship. Now I can know God. There's two important parts about our communication as believers. One is the Word, and the second is prayer, all right? Those are two important elements. If we miss those, then we miss it completely. Somehow it's jumping past me again. I'll let you run it back there if it works, all right? The two ways, one is Word, the second is prayer. In the Word, this is so important to your prayer life. If you ignore the Word of God, you really don't have an effective prayer life because it's in the Word that God reveals Himself. God walks on these pages. You've heard me say that before. It's in His Word that God shows you who He is. He shows you how He works. He shows you what He's done and what He's going to do. It reveals to you, if you'll take the time with it, God's will and purposes. When you come to life choices and life decisions, if you're in the Word of God, God will open up that Word and reveal it to you and make it clear of what He's saying to you. It's kind of like I was looking at my iPad the other day and all of a sudden it went real dim. It says, iPad battery's low, is going into power saving mode. You ever had that happen? No. You know? Some of you are living your life in power saving mode. It goes real dim. There's not a lot of light. There's not a lot of effect. You got to strain to understand it. You know, I don't want power saving mode. I want light, all right? And light comes from the Word of God. If you don't have the Word of God as a real integral part of your Christian walk and your Christian life and your daily life, then you're living your life in power-saving mode. You were created and then recreated in Christ Jesus to know Him personally as your Lord and Savior. And that's not to know about Him or have some kind of first little knowledge of shaking hands and saying it's good to know you. It's about a consistent, intimate relationship. And it is in prayer, is where that in communion with God, that you begin to develop that. It's in His Word and praying over His Word that you begin to understand that and you begin to perceive that. If you're not in the Bible, and if you're not a regular studier of Scriptures, your prayer life, I hate to tell you this, is really ineffective. Yeah. Come on. You say, why do you say that? Because this is what the Bible teaches us. Second Peter, Peter's addressing the church, and he says, listen, it's the Bible. God has given us these exceeding great and precious promises, that by these promises, you might participate in the divine nature. What? Let me say it again in English for you that don't read Bible. God gave you the Bible, and it's filled with His promises so that you could participate in His life. Life with Jesus. Life with God. So that it's a real part of your living. That I'm living today in participation with God. Boy, what an invitation, amen, when you think about it. That God's inviting us to commune with Him, that God's letting us be a part of communing with Him. The Bible says in Him are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And if you're without wisdom and knowledge, well, you need to get to the Word of God. You can discover it there. God reveals Himself in the Bible. God reveals His will in the Bible. God reveals His purposes in the Bible. How can I, as a Christian, expect to live the Christian life without the Word of God? And not only that, you say, well, it's hard to understand. You've got the translator on board. The Holy Spirit comes, and He is the teacher, the Bible says. What's He teach me? He teaches me the Bible. Which teaches me the Father, which teaches me the Son, which teaches me the promises, which teaches me that I relate to God on the basis of promises. The Scripture refers to Him as a covenant God. In other words, we relate to Him on the basis of these promises. Come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, I will give you rest. There's a promise from God. How's that apply to my life? I'm tired, wore out, and stressed out, and beat up. Come unto me. I think I need to spend time with God. What am I doing? I'm believing. I'm trusting. I'm possessing what He said I could have in my life. But if I don't come into Him, then I'll just live my life all beat up, stressed up, wore out. Amen? Yeah. So there's those elements. One is the element of the Word, and the second is the element of prayer. They work together. They're combined with each other. It's where God kind of brings the light to me, and I kick out of power-saving modes, and I begin to see what the Bible is really saying. God opens my heart. He opens my mind. So I speak to Him. And really, my prayer is based upon knowledge, the knowledge of God that God reveals to me through His Word. So the more familiar I am with God and His Word, then the deeper the relationship can go in our lives, in my life. Hey, do you understand that? If you got that, then I say, uh-huh. If not, we can spend another 10 minutes here. I got all day. It's raining outside. So those are the two important elements of communion. But understand this. God, the object of communion, bottom line, is to get to know your Heavenly Father, is to get to know God. And as I said a while ago, what an invitation. There's a verse in Deuteronomy 29:29 that says this, the secret things belong unto the Lord our God. In other words, there's some things you're never going to know. But it goes on to say, but those things which are revealed belong to us, and to our children forever and ever, that we may all do the words of the law. In other words, that we can do what God expects, what God desires, what God wants to be fulfilled in our world around us. We can do those things. And how do we do it? He says, they will be revealed to us by the Word of God. So it's in my time with the Lord. First of all is the communion part. I want to know God. And I can do that by studying His Word, praying over His Word, and seeing how He responds to my life and moves in my life as my Heavenly Father. So the object ultimate is to get to know God our Father. Now communion, and we talked about adoration, confession, thanksgiving, all that a while ago. Communion itself has several facets. And let me just give you these quickly. And they really can be, are you going to run it back there? Okay, I'll let you run it. The communion has several facets. And it breaks down like this, adoration, thanksgiving, and confession. Now they can come out different ways and different levels. I mean, but I believe all prayer, if we're going to get into God's presence in this time of communion with Him, starts with this point of adoration. It's It's adoring God for who He is, praising the Lord for who He is, understanding that He is the God of the universe, that He's God over all things, that He's the sovereign Holy One of all the world, that He created all things, He's the beginning of all things, He's the end of all things, that He is sovereignly God. There was none before Him, there's none after Him, there will none ever be like Him. He's God and there is no other, this Bible says. So I want to go into the Lord's presence and begin to bless the Lord. Psalms 34 is a great illustration of this. In verses 1-3, 1-4, it says this, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul will make her boast in the Lord, and the humble will hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt His name together. I sought the Lord, and He heard me, and He delivered me from all my fears. This is just a point where David is entering the presence of God, and not only is he blessing, he's encouraging everybody to enter into this realm of praise and adoration. And some of you, I know that's hard for you. You're like, you've been drinking starch or something. You're all, you know, clogged up in the praise canal of your mouth or something. It just can't come out. You just have a hard time blessing the Lord and extolling the Lord and adoring the Lord. If you ever break through that barrier, your life's going to change. Your attitude of adoration is something not just in our prayer time, but it ought to be carried on through our life. The second element of that is thanksgiving. Now, really, you can go ahead and run the third one up too, which is confession. Sometimes these can be flip-flop, but I really believe we enter into His presence with thanksgiving and adoration and praise. Now, as we do that, I guess I'd put the third one up again, the confession. Sometimes I found that after I've spent some time adoring the Lord, I need to confess right then. Because it's like I get out of power saving mode and I'm starting to look to the Father. I'm not looking at the dim things of the earth, which grow strangely dim. I'm looking at the Father and things get strangely bright. And I start looking at Him. It's like Isaiah said, I saw the Lord. And then he said, I saw myself, said, woe is me. When we get in God's presence, guess what happens? The lights do come on and God begins to show us where we're at. And many times it's like a spiritual battle takes place here because Satan's the accuser of the brethren. So he likes to enter in with guilt and say, oh, you don't have the right to ask God anything because look at you, you're sorry and stuff. And you know, you can't, hey, it's important we get right with God. So just let that backfire in the devil's face when he comes with condemnation, turn it into conviction and start confessing your sin. Just say, devil, you're right. I'm going to Jesus. I blew it. I'm going to Jesus. I failed. I'm going to Jesus. I made a mess of it. I'm taking it to the cross. And we get it right. But these elements all work together, I believe, as we're adoring God, as we're confessing Him and confessing our sins and expressing our attitude of gratitude to the Father, God begins to move in a very unique way in your heart. It's like you're positioning yourself, you're pulling yourself out of this secular mindset that we so easily stay in all too often and getting to a spiritual place in your life and just a quiet place where you can hear God, you can speak to God, you can hear what He says to you, and you can express your heart to Him. And when this is about getting your focus set properly. And this is so important, an aspect of our prayer life, because Satan will fight you, as we said last week, probably in this area as much as any other or more than any other area in your life. The Bible tells us this, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request. Let your request be made known unto God. 1 Thessalonians 5 says, give thanks in everything, for this is God's will in Christ Jesus concerning you. What am I thanking God for? I'm thanking God for everything He's done, all that He's doing. In adoration, I'm thanking God for who He is. In thanksgiving, I'm thanking God for what He's done. And I don't know about you, but I have plenty to thank the Lord for. If you take some time and start writing it down, you might blow your own mind. But then you come to this place of saying, all right, I need to confess, because if I'm going to pray right, I need to be right. And to be right is to let the lights come on. There's an old poet, he was a preacher by the name of Joseph Cook years ago, who wrote this little saying. It says, light obeyed increased the light. Light resisted bringeth night. Who shall give us power to choose if the love of light we lose? There's a lot of people who've lost the love of light. In the book of Proverbs, we've been going through that on Wednesday nights. We've been through 10 or 12 chapters here at this campus. We're back over Magnolia doing it on Wednesday nights now. But the book of Proverbs, it talks about the difference between a wise man and a foolish man. And it says, a wise man loves instruction, but a foolish man cannot stand rebuke. Now, what's happening is, word is going out, instruction is coming. The wise man sees it as an opportunity to get closer to God. The foolish man sees it as a rebuke. It's like two people can sit in a sermon at Believer's Fellowship on Sunday morning, and somebody can walk out and say, "Oh man, I'm so nourished." And somebody else walks out mad. Amen? I'll let you decide which is which. Increases the light or increases the night? I want the light increased. So there's that element of upward. Then the second part of that was the inward part. In Hebrews 4, it says, we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness. Somebody say amen. We have one, this high priest, who has been tempted in every way, just as Joe Arms is, just as we are, yet without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace. He's talking about prayer. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. Here is God himself through his word inviting us to a place in his presence to present our needs to him. That's petition. I have a lot of stuff I need to pray about. I don't know about you. I have family and marriage and money and jobs and the culture and all kinds of the church. I got a lot of stuff on my prayer list. How about you? Yeah. Amen. Maybe you don't even have a prayer list. You ought to get one. Works wonders. You got a lot of stuff you're praying for. The best thing about that is that God invites you to bring it to him. Bring it here. I know how you're feeling. I know how that hurts. I know how that works. I was flesh and blood too. Come. You're not praying to somebody who doesn't know what you're going through and what you've experienced. I know. Come. Come. And he calls it, I love this, he calls it the throne of grace, the place we receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. That's the petition aspect, all right? So there's adoration, and communion, which is the upward part, and then there's the inward part of petition, and then there's this all-important element of the outward part, intercession. In other words, it doesn't stop with me. I made this point back in our last series of messages when we were talking about against all odds, that God does marvelous things for his children. God does incredible things, many times supernatural things for us, things that are out of the norm, that naturally and normally would not happen in the course of human events. But God intervenes in our life in so many different ways. One day when we get to heaven, we'll see it was probably a whole lot more than what we ever realized. But he comes in and he moves and he speaks to us. But it never happens. He never does this great blessing. He never does this great work in my life, really just for me. In other words, it's not all about me. It doesn't end with me. God does something in me so that I can see it done in someone else. The Bible puts it this way. We are comforted with God's Holy Spirit, and he comforts us so that we may in turn comfort others. In other words, God saved me, it just wasn't for me. It's so I can tell other people about it as well. God answers prayer. It's not just for me. So I can tell people, hey, God answers prayer. Here's what he did for me. And it can be an encouragement. It can be a blessing. This is where prayer pours out of just my petition and my need to reach out and minister to others. Now, I shared this passage from 1 Samuel last week. Moreover, it's for me. God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. But I will teach you the good and the right way. Now, this is a powerful verse if you think about it for a moment. What the prophet is saying is, if I'm not praying for you, I'm sinning against God. And I think if our prayers only stop at our doorstep, if we're only concerned about ourselves, then we are sinning against the Lord. It's like the lepers we talked about several weeks ago who went out, and remember, why sit here till we die? And they went into the enemy's tents, and the enemy had fled in the night thinking that the invaders were coming and left everything. And the lepers go in and they start hiding everything and keeping it for themselves. And then finally they said, we do not well. This is a day of blessing. We do not well if we keep everything for ourselves. We do not well if all we do is pray for ourselves. It gets beyond ourselves. And here's the thing about it. There's this principle of the harvest that's in operation that says we reap what we sow. Whatsoever man soweth, that will he also reap. In other words, if I'm praying for others, I believe others are praying for me. God just has a way of burdening people and putting my need on other people's heart as well as he puts their need on my heart. And so there's this fellowship and communion with my Father, but also I'm bearing the needs of other people in him. It doesn't stop with me. Romans 1:9 says, for God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers. Man, what a statement. Yes. Here's somebody that says, I'm praying for you. All the time I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you all the time. And I think that God brings people to our lives that's the way it's supposed to be. We're supposed to be praying for them. A lot. A lot. And there are people who God wants us to be praying for. Sometimes it's family members, all right? Sometimes it's next door neighbors. Sometimes it's church members. Sometimes it's the whole body of Christ, but we're praying. In Ezekiel 22, the Lord says, I search for a man among them who would build up the wall and would stand in the gap before me for the land that I should not destroy it. But I found no one. What's God saying? I've been looking for a man. This principle is mentioned many times throughout Scripture, that God is looking for people who volunteer themselves to His will. That God is looking for somebody who'll pay attention. God's looking for someone who'll make a difference in the world around him. God said, I need somebody to come. And the word is to stand in the gap, to stand in the gap before the land, was the idea of I'm standing here between heaven and hell. I'm standing here on behalf of somebody else. I'm stepping into that gap, so that Satan can't pour into that life. And I'm going to stand there, and I'm going to be the one who prays. I'm going to be the one who lifts that person up to the Lord. I'm going to be the person who prays for their salvation. I'm going to be the person who prays for their needs in their life. I'll be that person who takes them to that throne of grace and lifts them up to the Lord and prays that God will do something glorious in their life and for His will and for His purposes. The tragedy of that verse is that, but I didn't find anyone. I didn't find anyone. And I wonder today if that same verse is being written about our church, how many of us are really coming up to say, I'll stand there, I'll be the person who catches the heart of God here, who finds the mind of God and uses it in prayer and reaches out. Many times this kind of praying, intercession, is really gets down to warfare praying. And we'll talk more about warfare praying in a discussion later, a couple of weeks from now. But this is a very important aspect of your prayer life. But let me wrap this all up this morning with just a few verses of Scripture and try to make a clear point about all our prayer. We looked at those levels of upward and inward and outward. Let me make some clear points about, as we pray, how do we have prayers that God answers? Because that's the kind of prayers I'm interested in, amen? The one that I know I'm praying, it's God's getting it done. Understand this, and this is hard for some people to get. The purpose of prayer is to see the Father's will be done. Bottom line. God in heaven moving in a man on the earth, a woman on the earth to get His will done in the earth. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is where? As it is in heaven. Excuse me. Thy will be done on earth as it is in my heart. As it is in my perception of things. Or it is, thy will be done as if it's done the way I want it to be done. Now, all too often, we can be guilty of praying like that, right? Just, I'm trying to twist God's arm, get Him to do my will, my thing. This is what I want. But if you study prayer, you start seeing a unique principle kind of pull and open and reveal itself as you seek God's face and what prayer is really all about. That really the bottom line is seeing this God in heaven who's given us these great, exceeding, precious promises that wants us to participate in that divine nature of His will and purposes for our life, that in prayer we discover what God's up to. In prayer we begin to discover what His will in heaven is so that we can pray with it and agree on it and move on it in the earth. Someone put it like this. That prayer is finding the mind of God and agreeing with it. I remember Mickey Bonner who said, God doesn't answer any prayer that doesn't originate with Himself. I didn't like that the first time I heard that. Excuse me? But that's the truth. The key to answered prayer is the will of God. You hear me? The key to answered prayer is the will of God. How did Jesus get His prayers always answered? He prayed according to the will of God. How do you get your prayers answered? Learn how to pray according to the will of God. Well, how do you do that? So glad you asked. I just told you. It's prayer and communion with God and His Word. As you know His Word, you know His mind. As you know His mind, you begin to discover how God works. You begin to understand His will. And I believe, since you have this receiver, the Holy Spirit on board, that the Holy Spirit of God will illuminate your heart and your mind through the Word of God as to what you ought to pray, how you ought to pray. And as we learn how to pray like that, what's the will of God? It will blow your mind as to what God will do in response to your prayers because you are praying according to the will of God. That's why it's so important. Let me reiterate one more time. To be in the Word of God. It's in the Word of God that I can discover what God's will is for my life. I can discover what God's will is for my wife's life, for my children's life, for my church. Amen? On my job. I can pray for my boss, you know, effectively. Not that God kill him. But realize that God's trying to do something in my boss's life too. So I need to be praying for him. God, what do you want me to pray? It's all in here. It's all in here. The forgotten book, we ought to call it. Amen. The lost book. We're so visually entertaining, but we don't know how to open a book. Well, if that's hard, get it on your iPhone. Put it on your iPad. Put it on your Surface Pro, whatever you're doing. Your laptop. But for old schoolers, it's still in written form. Amen. Some of you fit that bill. Some of you get on a computer and get your thumb stuck in the keyboard. I know how it is. Listen to what Jesus said. He's giving us, when Jesus is talking to his disciples about the Word of God and how God works and how Jesus said, here's how God works in my life. I mean, you know, he's telling them, hey, it's by prayer and faith, but the real key to answering your prayers and seeing is seeing God's will done. Listen to what Jesus says in this, back to John 5, all right? Therefore, Jesus answered and was saying to them, truly I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself. Let me read that part again. Stop. Don't read ahead. Just read one more time. The Son can do nothing of himself unless it's something he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, these things the Son also does in like manner. For the Father loves the Son. They have a relationship. And the Father shows the Son all things that the Father's doing. And the Father will show him greater works than these so that you will have your minds blown. So you'll marvel at the grace and greatness of God. You'll bring glory to God. What's he saying? Remember, Jesus is God in the flesh, right? He's the Son of God veiled in flesh. And what Jesus is trying to teach, and this is repeated throughout the Gospels, he's trying to teach the disciples, the life I'm living, I don't live on my own strength, by my own power. I'm trusting the Father for everything. Let me tell you this, you might not understand this, but Jesus lived a life of faith. He lived this life completely by faith. You say, what do you mean? He found out what the Word of God was, what the Word of the Father was, and he believed it. All right? That's why you spend a lot of time in prayer. What do you want to do in this situation? What do you want to do? I'll be in Nazareth tomorrow. What's going to happen? I'll be in Galilee tomorrow afternoon. What are we going to do, Father? What would you like to see? We're going to be going across in the sea tonight in Capernaum. What do we do? The Lord says, I want you to stay here. Send them out. All right? Say, how do you know that? Because this is the way he said he operated. This is what he said, this is how I operate. I find out what the Father wants to do. Some of you think that Jesus just walked on the water to blow the disciples' minds. You know, let's put him in the storm out there and then I'll come out on the water, I really freak them out. Watch this. He's not like a circus clown performing tricks or something. You know, he's operating according to God's will. I want you to do this. I have something I want to teach the disciples about faith and obedience. So let's. I'm going to do this supernatural act, and they'll understand. So that's why they ask him. We read a while ago in John, how do these works of God? How is this? And he said, hey, you'll do greater works than this. What is the greater work? The greater work is I can hear what God says to my heart, and through his word, he confirms it, and by his spirit, he gives me peace about it, and I can pray that and see God move. Listen. That's the way you got saved, whether you believe it or not. Amen. Saved by faith. Amen. You heard the Word of God. You believe the Word of God. You said what God said. Now, it's not this name it, claim it, frame it mentality that we have in the church, then some churches where you can just declare whatever you want to declare and make so whatever you want to make so. And, you know, God bless me, I'll be rich today. Well, not if it's not God's will. Amen. Being rich may wreck your life, and he knows that. You know? So it's not just name it, frame it. But what is God saying? Let me show you this from the Amplified. If you're familiar with the Amplified Bible, it's just that. It takes the Greek language in the New Testament, the Hebrew of the Old Testament, and it just amplifies the words a little bit to give it more clarity. It says here, so Jesus answered them by saying, I assure you most solemnly, I tell you, the Son is able to do nothing of himself of his own accord. He's able to do only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does is what the Son does in the same way in his turn. The Father dearly loves the Son and discloses and shows him everything that he himself does and will disclose to him, let him see greater things than these so that you may marvel and be full of wonder and astonishment. Jesus lived by faith. Faith comes by hearing by the Word of God. Jesus heard the Word of God as God spoke it and revealed it to his Spirit. And by the way, he's the living Word of God. But you have to understand, even though he's God, he didn't operate independently of the Father. Jesus never did a miracle of his own accord. He never preached a sermon of his own mindset. He could have. He's God in flesh. But he chose to live this way to teach us this is how we live. We live by faith. We live by reliance upon our Heavenly Father. We trust God. and we respond to what God says and what God does. 2 Peter 1 again, we participate in the divine nature. How? By the promises of God. We know the Word of God. And the more familiar we are with the Word of God, then the more we can hear God speak. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice and they know it. In other words, the more intimately I become familiar with the voice of God, it's because I'm becoming familiar with the Word of God. You can't have one without the other. A lot of people want to hear from God, but they don't want the Word of God. It's not going to work. You just become a mystic. You're not a spiritual person. It's a soulless kind of Christianity. Here's Jesus, and remember this verse, he's going down about 10 verses from what I just read now, and I'll read to you from John 5:30, and he's just making the point because we're all a little dense, right? So he says to him 10 verses later, I am able to do nothing for myself independently of my own accord, but only as I'm taught by God, and I get his orders. Even as I hear, I judge. I decide as I'm bidden to decide, as the voice comes to me. So I give a decision, and my judgment is right. It's just and righteous because I do not seek or consult my own will. I have no desire to do what is pleasing to myself, my own aim, my own purpose, but only the will and the pleasure of the Father who sent me. May that be our heart's cry and prayer. Lord, I'm not here to seek my will. Man, we ought to have figured it now. If we get our will all the time, listen, when you chose to live without Jesus and you pursued your own will, how'd that work for you? In your life as a Christian, when you decide, I'll just ignore what God's saying and do what I want to do, how's that working for you? It doesn't. It's a way of misery. It's a way of pain. It's a way of death. But in prayer, we're getting a heart that just says, I want to know God. I want to know God's word. And the more I absorb it, the more I receive it, the more it becomes a reality. So I see that Jesus just did what he did is according to the Father's will. How should I live my life? You should live. Well, we ought to get to the point where we can say, hey, I'm doing what I do because this is what God wants me to do. And then get rid of all the stuff we're doing that we're just doing because we want to do it. How life would change, how prayer would change. So Jesus what? Well, Jesus makes it clear. He only did what he saw and what he heard. Catch this verse in Matthew 18. This has been a misunderstood verse. In fact, Catholic Church has really taken this out of context. But it says, verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on the earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And that's the King James translation of that passage, which most of the King James is just a really good job with translation, right? But it missed the mark on this verse completely. And what it was trying to say from the original language was lost and somehow in the English translation. You know, we've talked about translations from one language to another, how you can lose something, you know, very clearly, what's really being said. I was trying to tell a guy one day in Norway, he was working on a sermon, working with my translator, and I said, he ain't got any backbone. He looked at me like, what? No backbone? He'd fall over. He said, no, he didn't, you know, he won't stand up. He hadn't got a bone in his nose. Okay. Different languages, different idioms, different kind of context, but it certainly was lost in this verse. I'm going to sneeze first. Go ahead and say, God bless you. Thank you very much. Hallelujah. Matthew 18, let's read just from the Amplified Bible. It gives a little more clarity to the actual language and the language in. Truly I tell you, whatever you forbid and declare to be improper and unlawful on the earth must be what is already forbidden in heaven. And whatever you permit and declare proper and lawful on earth must be what is already permitted in heaven. See the difference between two verses? One verse says, whatever I want, I declare it. That's the way it is. But that's not what the verse is saying. It's the same principle you find in Matthew 6. Thy will be done on earth as in heaven. What does heaven want? What's God want? You know, we report to headquarters, you know? And that's where GQ is in heaven, all right? General quarters, that's where we get directions. That's where marching orders come from. That's where we get our instruction. He said, so what you're doing is you live your life according to what God wants, what the will of God, what the purposes of God, what's the plan of God. You say, well, I don't know what it is. That's why God gives us this avenue of prayer and his word and his spirit so that we can understand what his will is. But if we have no discipline for that, if there's no commitment to pray and there's no commitment to seek God and there's no commitment to the word of God, to read it or study it or memorize it, it's no wonder our prayers never get answered. Because we don't know what heaven wants. We don't know what God wants. We're just kind of working it out. Well, you know, maybe this is what's best. You know, God bless me. And that's when you get in that kind of prayer life. It's the bless me prayers. Y'all know what that is? You know, bless Uncle Bob, bless Aunt Sue, and bless little Bobby, and bless Mama, and bless Poppy, and Nani, and whoever. And just bless them. And that's the context of the prayer life. And bless, and God bless them too. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I'm not trying to shame anybody. But what I am trying to do is give some instruction, like Samuel said in that verse. Well, I want to give you the right and true way. And the right and true way is to get to know God, your Father. Amen. And get to know His heart. So that when you pray, you're praying according to His desire, not your desires. Understand that Jesus and the life of Jesus was only to do what He heard and what He saw. That was the work of God. And so when He tells the disciples up in John 6, we read a while ago, this is the work of God, that you believe on Him who sent me. Why? Because that's where you plug in it. You plug into Jesus. And how did Jesus have His prayers answered? He prayed according to the will of God. How did He know the will of God? He knew the Word of God. How did He become familiar? He spent time in the Word of God. Now, if Jesus lived that way, how about you? Jesus said, I'm not living of my own accord here. I'm not living by my own power. I'm not living by my own strength. I look to the Father for all these things. I can do nothing of myself. What about you? Remember Jesus in John 4 says, you'll do greater works, you know, than these. There's no greater life in your work ultimately when you discover this than it's in prayer. But catch what He says here. I'm the vine. This is few verses. In fact, these are the last words of Jesus to His disciples in John 15, 16, 17. This is the last recourse they had together. You're the branches. He that abides in me and I in him, that person's going to bring forth much fruit. For without me, you what? Nothing. For without me, you can do nothing. Well, isn't that powerful? Can we receive that? Are we so self-willed, so independent, we don't think we need God? We just do it on our own, my own. I'll just gut my way through this, man. I'm smart. I'll figure it out. No, you won't. You can't have, Jesus said, hey, if you want to live a fruitful life, you abide in me. And we'll talk more of the context of this next week, because I remember next week's and this week's sermon are just tied together, and they'll flow. And those who are in Lift Group, they'll be doing both these sermons, discussion, and a little deeper study into it next week. But understand, as we flow into this next sermon on this coming Sunday, is that we close here by saying, Jesus lived this way. He's told us this is the way we live. You learn to walk with God. You learn to hear God speak. This Christianity that leads and excludes the life, the power, the presence, the will of God out of a Christian life is anti-Christian. This kind of Christian life says, oh, just come to church, be a good person, keep the golden rule. That's hellish and devilish. That's not how you become a Christian. It's not how you live the Christian life. All right? There's some principles found in those things, but you got to do the very first thing. You got to come to Jesus. You got to plant your life in Christ. Then life begins. Then you can keep the golden rule. Then you can do the right things. But without Him, you can't do anything. Now, our culture doesn't believe this because we all think that we've been taught by our social world that we are all Superman and Superwoman, and we can do anything we put our mind to. Anything is possible. You can believe it. You can achieve it. Without Jesus, you can do nothing. And even if you do achieve something in this world, you're going to die. So where does it go? But in Christ, everything we do lives on through eternity. Amen. This is the life, the real life, to love Jesus, to know God, and to walk with Him, and to participate in the divine nature. And how do we plug into that? You can't do it without praying. It's just not going to happen in your life. Jesus said, you'll do greater works. What are those greater works? I think it's as we pray and we seek God. He's one person choosing to live by faith. He's the God-man. And he walked according to the will of God, and he laid down his life so that we could do the same. But how much more have we accomplished in the name of Jesus over the centuries? The church has done marvelous and great things for the glory of God. Great, marvelous things. And there's more to be done as we seek God's face together. You shall ask, but you ask in my name. And I'll talk a little bit more next week about in my name, because it's not a little magic talisman you put on into your prayer saying, okay, bless Uncle Bob, Aunt Sue, and in Jesus' name, amen. It has to do everything with everything I've just talked about. The presence, the person, and the will of God. So that when I pray in Jesus' name, it means that I'm coming to God my Father through Jesus Christ. He's my access and entrance, and I'm discovering what He wants. And now I'm agreeing with it and saying and repeating in the world and in the earth God's will. And God starts moving. I can come. If I see Satan attacking my family, I can find out what God says about that, and I can go to the Father, and I can agree with the Father, and I can find His will, and I can say, God, You said, first of all, You said, so I want to thank You for what You're doing. And you pray what He's promised. Hallelujah. Amen. That's faith. Asking, receiving, believing. Let's stand with our heads bowed. Just a few moments, we're going to have a